All right, I think we're going. Good. All right.
At least I hope it's recording the right thing. All right, so the deal with Solomon Northup is, you know, the movie is different from the book in key ways. Now, the movie does a really good job of condensing some storylines and merging them together and kind of giving you a visual representation of some of the stuff that you're reading. So the movie is very well done, even though it's not a carbon copy of the book, okay? So in fact, some of the questions that I ask in quizzes are intended to catch differences between the movie and the book. But I thought that this little trailer does a really good job of kind of reinforcing what we've been talking about overall. And we're getting to the end of the book, so we're really getting to where the punch is, right? I mean, what would you call that? The climax of the book, I guess, to use my literary terms. I have a second major in English, but I'm not a literature person, right? I'm a history person. So we're at that point, right? And so that's kind of what we're looking at. So we're going to talk about that some more, but first I wanted to talk about the discussion board. I've had a bunch of people asking me questions about the market economy. Now, you remember, we've been talking about the market economy since the start of the second quarter, right? That's the big concept. That's the whole big picture that has to do with tariffs, internal improvements, the Bank of the United States, the expansion westward, the labor systems, the competing labor systems of the factory versus slave, the social class system, how you have these emerging social classes, how you have an emerging globalized economy. It's all those big concepts, okay? So what I'm asking you to do with the discussion board is analyze how do those values work, how do the American values that we talked about last week, the individualism, which is the ability of a person to work their way up, to improve their station in life, right? I mean, why do you want to go to college? Why do you want to go be trained to do fill in the blank, okay? The reason you want to do that is because you don't want to flip hamburgers your entire life, okay? That's individualism. That's the thing inside of you that says, I'm capable of more, right? And for some people, and that's the thing about individualism, it's different for each person. One person, it's going to be, I want to have a PhD. I want to be a medical doctor. I want to be an engineer. For another person, it's, I want to own my own business. For another person, it could be, I want to raise my family. I want to stay at home and take care of my kids. I mean, all of those are equally valid. It's not a question of choosing, well, it only has to be this way, okay? The issue is not what plan you choose. The issue is that you have the ability to choose whatever plan you want. That's individualism. So when we analyze the role of individualism, if you look at these big concepts of the market economy, how do those things fit together? How does slavery, how does the factory system, how do those things work? How do social classes work in individualism? You're talking about populism. You're talking about the right of people to participate politically, right? So how does the expansion of suffrage in the 1800s, the lowering of property requirements, affect populism? How do social classes and wealth affect populism? How does it practically function during a presidency like Andrew Jackson, where you have a president who's really being elected by the common will of the people and by the common people's desires, as opposed to the governance of the country that's being run by men like Henry Clay and John C. Calhoun, who clearly represent a certain social class? Those are conflicts, okay? When you're talking about laissez-faire, how much control does the government have in the economy? What is the Bank of the United States? What is, tariffs? You know, how do tariffs fit within a hands-off the economy mentality? Does that work? If you're in the South and you have to buy most of your goods from factories up north, protective tariffs make it hard for you to have a whole lot of choice about what you buy. Instead of having five different producers of the same item, you have two, which means you're going to pay a higher price. In addition, it's going to mean that your the cost of your goods, or of what you're selling, the cotton you're selling, have fewer markets or have less power in the market economy because there's no competition happening. That's what laissez-faire is. It's the government coming in and removing competition from what is really a capitalist system. Except for manufacturers, that's a nice thing because having tariffs means, well, hey, I don't have to compete with foreign producers. Remember, Britain was way better than the United States at making stuff all through most of the 1800s. Okay, it's not until after the Civil War that you see the United States gaining an edge. So that's where that's going to come into play, right? We still talk about tariffs and trade. That's why there's concern about the Trans-Pacific Partnership, the TPP, and what is that going to do to American manufacturing? That's why people say NAFTA was a bad deal, right? That's why people say our trade with China is in a bad condition because we have an unfair trade arrangement that hurts American manufacturers and costs jobs. So it's not as simple as saying, oh, well, they're damaging capitalism, okay? Because there's pros and cons to that. That's a tension within laissez-faire, right? Having a stable economy through creating a Bank of the United States helps Western expansion, except that's not laissez-faire. So which one do you want, right? For the first part of the 1800s, Southerners were okay with having this kind of arrangement because they got something out of it. They got Western expansion, some slave territories, that kind of thing, right? But as time goes on, they get increasingly unhappy with that situation. So laissez-faire is an issue. Equality, men and women, blacks and whites, right? Those are your essential conflicts, but you can even talk about Native Americans and whites. You know, because the Native Americans are the ones who are pushed out so that whites can take over the land. So you've got essential questions about equality. If you're talking about liberty, what freedom do people have to say what they want, to believe what they want, to do what they want? What freedom do blacks have? What freedom do people who oppose slavery in the South have? What freedom do factory workers have up north, right? So there's lots of tensions and conflicts inherent to the market economy. So that's what you're doing. So it's the big picture, this overall system, with these five values and how those values really rub against each other a lot, okay? And guys, it's a big concept, and it's an important one because it doesn't change. It does not change. I don't care whether it's 1845 or whether it's 2016. These values and this system, the market economy, democracy, all of that stuff, they push against each other. They're constantly fighting it out over which one's supreme. And that it's that creative tension that creates the United States of America. And so understanding there's a creative tension there is very important. Okay, so that's what you're doing in the discussion board. So it's a very holistic kind of exercise, actually. Okay, does that make sense? All right, because people were trying to find very specific things, and I'm like, no. So anyway, so I wanted to be sure and clarify that. All right, so now let's talk about Northup, shall we?
Do I want to blink that? Maybe. I don't know. Do I? Where's my thing? Here it is. All right, so let's talk about... surely it won't stop recording if I blank the... So I don't have to have that light hitting me in the face, right? It shouldn't. Hopefully not, otherwise I'll be recording. Okay. All right, so let's talk about Northup. This is when I wish I had one here. Okay. All right, so chapter 19... What do we see as a situation at the beginning of that? How does chapter 19 start? Sort of. Bass shows up. Why does he show up? He's building a house. What does this tell us about Epps? He got richer. He's moving on up.
right? Cue the Jefferson's theme song. Moving on up to the side. Never mind. Clearly, I'm too old. Okay, so we've got the sign of his social status. Let me ask you this. How will Epps feel by 1859? How's he going to feel about slavery? It's a part of his life. What else is it?
Since he lost Solomon,
well, that's true. He's obviously not happy he loses Solomon. How important is slavery to his trajectory?
Very
incredibly. Exactly. This is the reason he's doing well. Okay. Now we can speculate as to what specific role Solomon has in that, and Solomon Northup doesn't tell us. I mean, we don't know. We can only speculate. I would think that Solomon Northup is a part of why he's doing well. Okay? So, you know, I think that there's an argument to be had there. So he's going to be very, very concerned about slavery. So do you see why when we get to 1860, anybody who's working their way up this little social ladder in the South is going to feel very personal about slavery, right? This is where that way of life mentality comes from. Even though practically speaking, right, abolitionists, people up north, anti-slavery people, those of us in the 21st century can look backwards and we can say, oh, why did they realize that their interests were more aligned with someone else? Because it doesn't work that way. When you buy into a system, when you believe that this is the system, this is the way I get from point A to point B, especially if point B is on an incline and I'm trying to work my way up, I'm going to be bought in and invested in that. And don't try to tell me that what I'm invested in is wrong. Why do you think so many millennials are upset about politics and college tuition? Why are millennials upset about the cost of college and student loans? Think in terms of yourself. You've gone into debt for about $100,000 to get a master's degree, and you're having trouble finding a job. How are you going to feel? Pretty crappy. Why are you going to feel crappy?
Because now I'm in debt.
Now you're in debt.
The whole reason you went to college was that you wouldn't have to struggle to get a job.
Yes. And now you find out, wait a minute, it doesn't work that way. Okay, that's how these small planters, these poor whites that maybe had a couple of slaves, that's how they would have felt. They would have felt lied to and betrayed if all of a sudden you convinced them that slavery was wrong, that this wasn't the answer. So that helps you understand the overall kind of resistance to seeing slavery as anything other than this is my way up. Okay, so you have to understand that. Because otherwise we fail to appreciate why the Southerners as a group supported slavery to the extent of secession and civil war. You don't understand their kind of we're all in mentality if you don't see that. Okay? And it's hugely important. Okay, and it's sociological tendency too. All right, what are Bass's circumstances? What's unique about Bass? He's Canadian. What else?
He's pretty much an abolitionist.
He's an abolitionist. Why does he get away with saying that stuff? I mean, most people would be lynched, wouldn't you think? So what makes him able to say this?
They think that he's just playing devil's advocate.
Okay. He doesn't really, well, or maybe that he does mean it, but okay. He's a Canadian. Does he have family or property? No. Right? So this is somebody that, you know, I mean, he's been there a few years, so they know him enough to know that he's fundamentally harmless. Okay? He's not going to practically do anything, right, that's going to upset somebody. He's not going to go around and literally set slaves free. Wink, wink, so they think. Right? But, I mean, he's been there for 3 years, and that hasn't happened. So he argues about slavery, but he's also kind of participating with it, isn't he? He's living with it. He's surrounded by it. He's working for slave owners. How much trouble does he have? I mean, it's like me being an environmentalist. Yeah, I'm concerned about climate change, but I'm terrible about recycling. So, you know, obviously, my passion for the environment has its limits, right? So that it's that kind of thing. When you're complicit with the system, you can argue about it, but, you know. And he's the exception. You know, he's eccentric. He's from Canada. You know, every good society can have that devil's advocate voice. It's kind of like me being the token liberal on campus, right? I mean, you know, when anybody wants to talk about liberal stuff, oh, Miss Green, right? I mean, we all know it, right? I know it. So, I mean, it just is, right? Aren't they cute? You know, they're nice. They play well with others. So we'll tolerate their unique opinions, that kind of thing. And I say that, you know, tongue in cheek. I don't really feel that way. But it's kind of, that's kind of the idea, right? We can allow differences of opinion so long as there's parameters, okay? That's why Bass can get away with saying the things that he says. And I think it's very important to kind of recognize how he can get away with that. What are the key aspects of his slavery argument?
That they're humans too.
That they're humans too. Humanity. What else?
That, like, white men are monkeys too. Or, like, there are monkey white men too.
Kind of. Yes. Well, he does say that. So you've got humanity. You've got the notion of equality, right? So he's talking, in essence, with the idea of individualism, I think is what you're talking about.
He says, like, the only reason that slaves are ignorant and dumb is because the master won't learn anything.
Yes. And that's where he makes the conversation, the point about monkeys and about there being dumb white men.
That's all.
Right? Yeah, that you've got... That slaves are not enabled to be what they can possibly be, and white men are not necessarily any more gifted, and so why are we using skin color as the criteria, right? How do we really know? Like, there's elements underneath there. So it's that individualism, that opportunity that's underneath all of this, right? So again, that kind of Tocqueville value. What about, so that's where the racial component comes in. What about liberty? Doesn't he talk about liberty?
How the slaves will one day have their justice.
It talks about that. That if we have that. Talks about the sin of it, right? What is his argument about property? What's his argument about kind of the laissez-faire aspect of it? If we were to one day come in and end slavery, what does he tell Epps?
He says that there's no justice in the law or the Constitution that allows one man to hold another man in bondage.
Yes. That basically the essence of our legal system is in question because we deny their liberty. And then he goes on to say, it would be hard for you to lose your property. I acknowledge that. Nobody's saying that it's easy. But the law, liberty, humanity, morality, the Declaration of Independence, all of these things lend themselves to ending slavery, to it being wrong. And Epps just laughs it off. It's not even... Like, it's so out of Epps's concept that he doesn't even begin to know, right? I mean, that's one of the sad things. Did you notice that Bass uses the N-word pretty liberally?
Yeah.
Is that a lie?
I don't like accuse him of anything? Or, like,
no.
Is that just a common word?
I think it's a common word at the time. And I think, and this kind of speaks to the inherent racism and paternalism that existed up north. Okay? In other words, part of it, okay, part of it is that way back when, like back when my grandparents, when I was little, I mean like little, my grandfather used to refer to Black Americans as coloreds, okay? Meant no disrespect, okay? They just, you know, that colored guy. And that's just what he said. I mean, the NAACP is the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, okay? It was a term that everybody kind of owned. Now, the N-word would have been a term that every white person owned, all right? I don't, whether blacks owned it, I would beg to differ. I mean, obviously, there's lots of arguments now about the use of the N-word being taken back by black communities, right? I mean, so there's a linguistic kind of ethnic sociological argument there. But white people in the 1800s certainly all owned the N-word. Okay, that's where the problem comes in with the N-word, right? White people were okay with it. Somebody like Bass, who is obviously opposed to slavery, is okay with that term because he doesn't see anything wrong with it, okay? He's been living for 3 years in this area, so it's probably one of those things that's just kind of come into his lexicon. The other part of it, too, is that when you're looking at the existence of slavery, being upset about a word seems pretty silly, right? You stop, I mean, there's bigger fish to fry, I guess is what I'm saying. Not that I think anybody likes the word, but they're probably just as insulted by the N-word as when a little boy calls an old black man boy, which happened a lot, okay? So the use of the word boy and girl, right, that was just as insulting as the N-word. So, all that being said, you have to, don't let the word throw you off, okay? But it's worth noting that that's an example of kind of inherent racism that existed all over the place, okay? So, this isn't just a matter of, oh, it's only in the South, okay? So, yeah, be sure you know that. The liberty, Bass says, suppose they pass a law taking away your liberty and making you a slave. Oh, that ain't a supposable case, said Epp, still laughing. And then he goes on to say, now in the sight of God, what is the difference between you and your slaves? So that's, you know, that's what he's talking about there. What about the credit system? What does Bass say about credit?
Well, it makes, like, he says it's a bad thing.
Okay, so why does that happen in the midst of this argument about slavery?
Slaves are
credit. Yes. They're property. How many times do people use slaves to make money, to borrow money? One thing you should know about the market economy is that the whole gist of cotton production is it focuses on credit. Like, you sell your product once a year, and you send it to market, you get your money, it goes into the bank, and they deduct what you owe. So that's why it's bad when the cotton price falls and the cotton market crashes. That's why Epps has to send his slaves off to Turner to work, because he's in that position, right? He has to make money. So he has to have money coming in because he's going to have to pay his creditors. So slavery is entwined with credit because of the cotton market, because of the market economy. And Bass is clearly saying that this is another level to the immorality. That in fact, perhaps one of the connections is that you start having to do something immoral because of credit. And then once you're in for a penny, you're in for a pound, right? You might as well. You got to wring every bit of profit out of these people because you owe money. Based on what they can produce. And that's where part of the evil of slavery comes from. You also see with Bass, very much this kind of market economy. I can't make it here, so I pack up, I move there. I can't make it here, I pack up, I move there. Kind of the transitory nature of many people during this period. Why is he concerned about telling Bass about his conditions. He goes into a lot of detail about, you know, how am I going to, you know, I think he might be favorable to me. How am I going to do this? What is his big concern?
He's already been betrayed once before.
Yes. Technically twice if you count
yeah.
Armsby. I mean, he didn't tell Armsby the whole story, but yeah. So he's got a good reason. What is the threat to Bass? Okay, why?
Because that was against the law of the white people.
Okay, well, it's not so much it's against the law of the white people. Uh-huh.
It's like you being downgraded, like kind of like the white man society, if he was a white man. Like,
isn't the only reason he's been tolerated because he's not a threat? So if he now engages with Northa over this issue, he now becomes a threat, and he becomes a threat that can't keep his mouth shut. How's that going to fly in the South? I mean, these are people that fight over a card game, right? I mean, we talked about the violence inherent to this Southern society. So, I mean, we saw Tibbetts, right? Why was Chaikin terrified after that exchange with Tibbetts? Because he knew that it wouldn't just be Northup that would be hurt, it would be him. Okay, so skin color doesn't protect you from the violence. And I think it's important to point that out. That's the real threat that he's got. Let's see. A matter of fact, goes on to say, having ended my story, I besought him to write some of my friends in the North, acquainting them with my situation and begging them to forward the free papers or take such steps as they might consider proper to secure my release. He promised to do so, but dwelt upon the danger of such an act in case of detection, and now impressed upon me the great necessity of strict silence and secrecy. Okay? So, what is the plan? What is their plan of action? Who will they write to? His friends. Why aren't they writing to his wife? Go. There's nothing she can do. First off, she's a black, right? Second off, she's a woman. Third off, she's a black woman.
Well, people they wrote to are white.
Yes, they're white. They have to write to white friends. What does that tell you about the North?
There's
a lot of racism. It's not completely equal. We touched on that way back at the very beginning. Remember when we talked about how much effort it took Northup to be at the level in society that he was at, that it was all hands on deck. His wife was working, he was working, it was everybody, right? And this is the product of a generation. Like it was his father that had managed to get his son a good starting place. And Northup's now trying to get his son a better starting place, right? Which is classic American individualism. And it's certainly far better than what exists in the South. But it's not the same for blacks that it is for whites. It's different. And this shows you right here that when he writes, he can't just say, honey, please do something. She's not going to get any traction anywhere. They have to send to his white friends. So, yes, they send to his white friends, to people that he knows.
Why wouldn't he still write to his wife when she doesn't know where he is?
Because they don't have the luxury of writing multiple letters. I mean, they do write multiple letters, but the more they send, the more likely there are to be problems.
Yeah.
Plus, right, he doesn't want to clue anybody in for who they're going to be asking for. Okay? And we'll get to that here in a second. So, I mean, when we say there's danger and you have to be careful, like, you can't apply the logic that you would use as a 21st century person, you know, oh, gee, who's the first person I want to write to? Oh, my family. No, you can't do that, okay? He has to think in a completely different level. And it's hard, I think, for us to appreciate that and how important that is. What is it that they write? What is it they tell these people?
Is it important that like, he mentions that it's
fast-writing and not his own?
Is incredibly
important. Is it because he's quiet?
Not exactly. What is it?
We're getting to it. Okay. It is incredibly important. So most of the letter is really a, this is what happened to me. This is where I'm at. Okay? Come help. But then there's this little postscript. The way I came to be a slave, I was taken sick in Washington City, blah, blah, blah. It gives the whole backstory. And have never been able to get anyone to write for me until now. And he that is writing for me runs the risk of his life if detected. Okay? So he's clearly telling them it's not just me. Okay? And that is hugely important. Hugely important. I do want to point out, first off, there's a couple aspects. First off, don't you think this is a prisoner of war mentality? I mean, this is akin to somebody trying to escape Nazi Germany or trying to escape, you know, the British during the Revolutionary War or trying to escape the Viet Cong in the Vietnam War. I mean, any kind of other concept. This is very much a prisoner of war mentality. What does that tell us about the existence of slavery in the United States?
Huh? It's pretty much like prison in a way.
It is like prison.
Mm-hmm. It was very difficult to get out of it.
It's difficult to get out of it. Isn't it inherently the country at war with itself from the beginning? If you look historically, over and over again, Thomas Jefferson, Mr. Slave Owner, I have an affair with Sally Hemings and have kids and keep some of them as slaves. Even he said that it was this bell in the night that to try to do something about slavery, I don't remember the exact analogy, it has to do with a wolf, and that would be like tackling a wolf and you risk being devoured with it. Okay? So, like, very clearly everyone understands. So I think recognizing this is the position he's in, I think, gives us some insight. And the other thing I want to point out is it only takes one person. It only ever takes one person to stand up and do the right thing. Okay? And if you're looking for a moral message behind Northup on top of all the political American history aspects, I think that's your message. It takes one person to say, you know what? This is wrong, and I'm going to choose, regardless of the risk to myself, to do what I know is right. Think about the people in World War II. Think about the people in World War I. I mean, you can think of any situation, McCarthyism, you name it, and you've always got those people that stand up and say, you know what, I don't care about the risk. I'm going to do the right thing because I have a conscience that I have to live with. And I think that Bass really shows you that. And I think that's he's a very compelling character to me in the choice that he makes, in the fact that he realizes this is his shot at redemption. And that it makes everything about his life, the 3 years he spent in Marksville, seem awful. And he kind of indicates that, you know, what have I been doing? That complicitness within a system, even though he complained about it, talked about it, argued about it, maybe that's part of why he was indulged, because he was full of hot air, right? He was just talking. Everybody knew he was just talking, except for him, until he's confronted with the situation with Northup. And then he's forced to make that choice. Is it just talk, or do I really believe this? And he clearly chooses that he really believes this, and he commits. And it takes that one person in that one moment to make that decision. And I think that's what's incredibly powerful about Bass's story. All right. Why is it useless for a black man to assert his freedom? And what does that mean about the law of the United States? Why is it useless for a black man to assert his freedom?
Since it's the whole, like, war mentality, I mean, a prisoner can't just say, oh, I'm free, because I'm not really
saying is that, you know, we know that there's legal systems in place, okay? Even Bass acknowledges that slaves are property. Property's protected, right? There's laws. We saw that with the Tibbetts altercation. You're not supposed to just be able to randomly kill slaves, okay? I mean,
if you were to, like, say, like, I was a free man, all it would do is just make his quality of life worse, because he would just be whipped into oblivion to keep his mouth shut, because there are those laws in place. And so his owners would try to make, like, to, like they did whenever he was captured, like, to shut him up,
yes,
to, like, change his mentality so he wouldn't,
yes,
put them at risk.
Yes, absolutely. In other words, he doesn't have any liberty, because if he asserts the truth, if he speaks for himself and says, hey, wait a minute, this is all a big misunderstanding, I'm really free, they're not going to say, oh, my goodness, how did this happen? Why don't you wait here, and we'll go find out the truth? No. Addie's absolutely correct. They will beat the tar out of him until they convince him that it's better for him to go along with the lie than to assert the truth. That's what they'll do. Okay? That's why I say it's a prisoner of war mentality. Truth is subjective in this thing, okay? And he knows that. He knows it does him zero good. What does that mean about the legal system in the United States? If the law is the thing that the Southern slave owners rely on as their fundamental right, this is my property, you can't take it. What does that tell us about the law? Yes, it's biased. Isn't justice supposed to be blind? Right? Isn't that the whole purpose of what is it, the Sixth and Seventh Amendment? Which is that, you know, the jury trial and the civil trial. Isn't that why we're supposed to have those things? Wasn't that one of the things that American colonists were most upset about? Was they weren't getting fair justice? Except it's not working that way for Northup. It doesn't work that way for anybody down south unless you're willing to go along with the system of slavery. Justice can be bought. And the slave system bought justice in the South. Over and over and over and over again. Okay? And that's the sad part. Going back to this issue of the law. How do we see the law affecting things up north? How is law impactful up north? In relation to slaves in Norfolk?
You can't just do what they want. You have to
do certain steps. Yes. They can't just say, let's pack up and go get them, can they? Did you catch how much proof they had to have? That's a lot of proof. Like, they had to go to the governor. First off, there has to be a law on the books. So we got the 1840 law that says, hey, you know, don't kidnap black New Yorkers. Then they have to go to the governor. Then they have to collect documentation. Prove that he's a citizen of New York. Prove that he was free. Right? Then they have to get approval to send somebody. And who do they get to send? A white man. Which brings us to Henry Northup. Okay? So, Henry Northup. What does him having the same last name tell us? Yes. Yes. Little example of northern paternalism right there, okay? So while the Solomon's family was free, they had a name that had been given them. He was given the name Platt, but even his original family name, Northup, had been given to him once upon a time. Make of that what you will, but it is a sign of paternalism. Now, it may not be immediate paternalism, Right. I mean, it may not be happening in Northup's generation, but it was certainly previous paternalism. So make no mistake, okay? You have a whole lot of, you know, oh, you poor thing, let us come help you, right? You can't do it yourself. We have to help you. We white people. White people are so great, right? We're so generous. You know, we create the system, and then we have to come help you out of it, right? But, oh, I swear, it was just coffee. So that's the whole point, okay, is that you have white paternalism existing up north, just like it exists elsewhere. I mean, arguably, you'd rather have paternalism over, like, outright slavery and racism, right? I mean, yeah, pick your poison. But make no mistake, it's kind of like the N-word, okay? Just because it's better doesn't mean it's okay, right? I mean, like, that's the thing that we tend to forget, right? And by we, I mean, I don't know, complacent society, white society, fill in the blank, right? When we say, well, what's the matter? Like, this is 2016. There's racism doesn't exist anymore. Don't you know that? The Supreme Court said it doesn't happen. Right? We don't have to worry about the Voting Rights Act because there's no indication that southern states try to do anything to keep black people from voting. No. Except the state of Oklahoma has, my mom was telling me, they've cut their polling places in half. She was visiting up there last week. She said there were lines around every polling place. Is that equal voting? I don't know. You decide, right? But I'm just saying, right? But that's the argument you hear. Oh, well, there's no more racism. It's not an issue. You don't have to worry about it anymore. Well, just because it's not as bad as it was doesn't mean it's not a problem. Doesn't mean you get to say, oh, well, we don't have to deal with that anymore, right? Ladies, it's the same for you. You know? I mean, when you're talking about issues of equality and individualism and liberty and populism, it, you know, just because it's better doesn't mean you should give up the fight for it. That's all I'm saying. So I think it's interesting to kind of note those examples of northern paternalism. Let's see. Why did the slavery arguments, the anti and pro-slavery arguments we looked at last week, why did they rely so much on morality? Why, I mean, think about it. The arguments we looked at, did they really follow the law? No. And yet, in reading this book, the law is pretty important, isn't it? Comes up over and over and over again in these three chapters. It's the continuous theme, right? X is entitled to his property by law. Declaration of Independence, those people aren't men, right? You have the law in New York that says, you know, this is what we have to do. We have to have white people take this paperwork. We have to travel down south. We have to have judges and a Supreme Court justice sign off on this stuff. You understand that this is essentially an argument between two states. It doesn't matter that Northup is a human being. In this instance, it's an argument between the state of New York and the state of Louisiana. Legally speaking, that's all it is. That's what it comes down to. His existence legally is so minor that it's really about who's in, you know, what state is he really a citizen of? Or is he just not a citizen because he's clearly property? That's the essence of the question. Okay? And so the law, when we talk about the defense of slavery or the anti-slavery argument, understand that the law is the thing that's tying all of this mess together. That's why these arguments are so pointless. That's why it was so pointless when you were arguing with each other. Because at the end of the day, both sides are right. Because the law is messed up. The law is jacked up on this. And there's just no other way around it. You've got to fix the law. Okay? That's where the power of fixing slavery comes from. You can argue till you're blue in the face about the Declaration and about religion and about science, but you got to fix the law. Because until you fix that, it just is what it is. And people can twist it and turn it and blind it and buy it off however they want to. Okay? And that's part of the message of seeing how much proof they have to get in New York to go rescue a citizen. Okay? So, the complacency of prosperity, be sure you understand. Bass spending 3 years there, you know, and kind of feeling it going along with it. All right, so that kind of gets us through 19. Were there any other observations about 19 that jumped out at somebody? Do you notice his reference to Uncle Tom's Cabin? The allusion to myself in the work recently issued entitled The Key to Uncle Tom's Cabin contains the first part of this letter omitting the postscript. Right? To the postscript, more than to the body of the communication, am I indebted for my liberation, as will presently be seen. Okay? Because after all, there are laws over this kind of stuff. All right. Let's see. All right, chapter 20. No other observations on 19? What is plan B in chapter 20? We see plan B. Bass will travel to New York himself, right? Basically, the gist of it is they're, you know, North says, please write again, and Bass says, I'm afraid. Why is he afraid? But what's the risk? What's he afraid of? The more the postmaster will know this. Why is he sending letters to New York? What does Bass have to do in New York? Right? It's the South. It's a small town. Right? You guys live in a small town. You know how that stuff spreads. Okay? I mean, that's literally all it takes is one random comment in the tavern, and next thing you know, the whole town's going, well, man, what's Bass up to? Right? All right. So, he's going to go to Saratoga. Notice he says, I have lived in this region long enough. I am tired of slavery as well as you. If I can succeed in getting you away from here, it will be a good act that I shall like to think of all my life. Okay?
So he actually went to Saratoga?
I thought he just No, he does not. That's plan B. Okay. He's going to go to Saratoga, but they haven't quite determined exactly when. Right? Because it's Christmas, right? We're at Christmas time. Happy, happy Christmas. Right? Notice he makes the tongue-in-cheek observation. It was to be a day of liberty among the children of slavery. Solomon has lots of sarcasm. I don't know if you've noticed that. Of course, it's easier to pick up on, like, the fifth time you've read it. But there's lots of sarcasm in here. We talk about the conversation between Bass and Epps, okay? What did we find out about Epps's perspective on Platt? How much is North slash Platt worth to Epps? A lot. 1700, right? That's a lot of money. $1,700. All right? He, like, paid what? $1,000 for him? $800, something like that, because he was known as a troublesome slave. What else do we find out about Epps and his perspective on Platt?
He thinks he can do, like, a bunch of hard tasks that he's really good at.
He recognizes his skill, doesn't he?
He realizes he stands out like there's something special.
Does. There is something very special about him. Right? But he's thin-skinned. He doesn't handle whipping very well. Yeah. He has to be gentle with them. Isn't that sweet? Yes. Epps knows he's different. Just like that, the trailer showed you. These people know that he's different. So that complacency of prosperity that we've talked about, what you see, Ford was complacent. He knew something was different. Chaitin knew something was different. But what risk do they take if they change the system? If they say, you know what, Platt, what's going on? You don't belong here. Tell me your story. They could have protected him, but what cost would they have had? What would they have risked?
Losing him.
Losing him and?
The money he's worth.
Not just the money. Their own life, their own status. I mean, there's a lot at risk here, okay? So, yeah, and Epps, I mean, I'll give Epps some credit. He probably didn't think real hard about it, right? He was like, man, I'm sure I'm lucky. I mean, Epps does not strike me as somebody who has a lot of inner reflection about situations, okay? So he probably didn't think very hard, although had he would have known. I wonder to what extent his wife knew, though there's some indication that she might have been aware that there was at least something off. But her complacency was, I like music, and I hate being married to this man. So better he suffer, and I have a little joy, than anything else, right? Plus, to what extent are the Epps' station in this area of Bayou Boeuf, how do you say that? To what extent is their status tied to the fact that they have a talented slave that travels around and plays the violin and is so talented with carpentry, right? Yeah, it does make them look good. It makes them look real good, right? We hear Mary McCoy. We hear about her Christmas. Why does he tell us on 191, he says, I dwell with delight upon the description of this fair and gentle lady, not only because she inspired me with emotions of gratitude and admiration, but because I would have the reader understand that all slave owners on Bayou Boeuf are not like Epps or Tibbetts or Jim Burns. Occasionally can be found, rarely it may be, indeed, a good man like William Ford or an angel of kindness like Mr. McCoy. So he clearly differentiates. Do you think he really believes that? What do you think?
That's what he says.
Yes.
Yeah. I think he recognizes, like, oh, they're good people, but, like, they're doing bad things because, like, that's just the culture of the South.
Okay. All right. So maybe he's giving them a pass.
Yeah.
What about his audience? When he wrote this.
I think he's also trying to be, like, he's saying that almost to appease the audience, to be like, I'm not a bad person, I don't hate whites, like, to give himself a
yes, person. Yes. I point this out to try to help you see that it was probably a very complex emotion, right? He makes it sound pretty simple in that little excerpt, right? Real simple. Oh, yeah, some people were good people. I don't bear any ill will against them. And he probably doesn't, really, but it's probably more complex than that. Because there's probably some baggage there, right? You know, when you know that Ford had to have known. And if you think back to when he talked about Ford, when he was at Ford's, he makes this little passing statement about how he felt that Ford must have known that there was something different, right? So you kind of get the sense that maybe there is, especially with Ford, a little more, maybe he could have done more. But then again, the system was the system, and they didn't create it. They were born into it just like he was dragged into it. So what can you really do? Which is part of the whole idea that slavery brutalizes everyone it comes in contact with. Unless you're X and you're already a brute, right? If you're already a brute, then I guess you're fine. But if you're a person that has zero level of brutality, it's going to make you to some degree brutal, whether you want it or not. Okay, and that's one of the really sad things about it, okay? All right, so chapter 20 is relatively short. We get a few details about Christmas. You see he gets one little whipping because he oversleeps, right? And then on the 3rd of January, 1853, this is the day. They're working. They get interrupted by a passing carriage, All right, so 1853. When you listen to the regionalized lecture, shortly after the Compromise of 1850, the Taft Fugitive Slave Act, you're beginning to have these stronger divisions. There's a lot more legal tension going on. So stick that in the back of your head. Interesting contrast between factory workers and slavery in that little section there at the end. Just kind of how they work, the lack of motivation, right? Let me whip you for being late to work. How is that more motivating than, say, fining somebody? Let me charge you because you're late to work. As opposed to, you know what, I'm going to beat you. Right? I mean, I don't know. Would that motivate you? Eventually, you would get immune to it. Some people would. All right, so then we get to 21. This is when we get a little more information about Mr. Northup, Mr. Henry Northup. We find out that the letter arrived in Saratoga in August. His friends forward the letter to Anne, so we see that. Okay, so again, that paternalism coming in. They have to go to Henry Northup, who's kind of this family connection, right? Again, paternalism. Especially if you're going to have somebody go down south, okay? We've got the law of 1840. It was necessary to establish two facts to the satisfaction of the governor. First, that I was a free citizen of New York. And secondly, that I was wrongfully held in bondage. Because anybody would willingly go. Right? I mean, I don't know. So then they used these letters. What do we find out about that first letter that was sent? What do we find out about the first letter? The second point rested entirely upon the letter to Parker and Perry, written in an unknown hand, and upon the letter penned on board the brig Orleans, which unfortunately had been later lost. Okay? So that first letter had disappeared. We have to have affidavits, we have to have statements, blah, blah, blah. We finally get in November, finally, what, 2.5 months later, we get approval from the governor to send Henry Northup as an agent of the governor to effect Solomon's restoration. Okay? What do you think about Henry having to wait to leave? He gets the message in November. He waits to leave until December. Yeah, but. Well, I mean, I think it is a priority, but I just think. Remember individualism. Now, I got stuff to take care of. You know? I mean, I got to get my business affairs in order before I can leave on this trip. Right, because, you know, I'm not the one held in bondage, okay? So individualism, again, conflicts, right? Doesn't mean you're a bad person, but it does mean sometimes you prioritize things differently. Certainly, Henry's priorities are different than Solomon's priorities, and probably different than Anne's priorities, because Solomon and Anne are probably like, yeah, dude, come on, right? So I think that's kind of interesting. All right, then we get to his traveling down, goes to Washington, D.C., speaks to the senator from Louisiana, the Honorable Pierre Soli, however you would say that, I don't know, my pronunciation is terrible. Why does he care about this situation? Why would he, a Southern senator, have any interest in the case of Solomon Northup? Isn't he supposed to like slavery? You don't know? Why? Why do you think he's going to care? What is the thing that slavery hinges on? the law.
So if somebody breaks the, if he allows people to break the law, then the system that's
in. Bingo. As the senator of a southern state who's in Washington, D.C., arguing over and over and over again that slavery is just, he cannot permit an injustice like Solomon's situation to exist. It can't. Because if that exists, the entire thing is flawed. See, that's the thing about the law. You know, it's a real bugbear. When you break it, you break it. And it's broken. You know, people can argue about bending it, right? No, you can blind it, you can buy it. You can corrupt it, maybe. Play a little smoke and mirrors with it. But bending it, no. You either break it or you don't. Okay? So the law is being broken. He is particularly interested in that and argues in forcible language that it is the duty and interest of every planter in the state to aid in restoring me to freedom. Okay? So we see that he clearly is against the situation of kidnapping. Now, the fact that it's happening on a regular basis, which if you've listened to the Regionalized America lectures at all, the Fugitive Slave Act, results in massive kidnappings. Okay, that are backed by the law. That's why the Fugitive Slave Act is such a terrible thing. Because it's the law that says, hey, people up north, you better help us go catch our slaves or else. You're breaking the law. Okay, that's why it matters. All these moral arguments about slavery, pointless. It's the law. Okay, the Fugitive Slave Act creates a law that makes it very, very difficult to escape, okay? It forces people to be complicit with slavery, whether they want to or not, at the risk of breaking the law. So that's where the crux of the matter comes, okay? So he has to make sure that the law is being upheld, especially in 1853, because they want the law to be upheld up north, so they better uphold the law down south, all right? All right, why is it significant? Well, okay, first off, let me point out the use of providentially. However, on arriving at the mouth of Red River, he changed his mind. Had he continued on and gone to New Orleans, he would not have met with Bass, in which case the search for me would have probably been fruitless. Why would the search have been fruitless? What do we find out?
Because he has no information on where he is and there's so many plantations.
He has no, exactly. And what? Yes, that's why the name change matters. That's why they beat it over and over and over again. That's why they took away the slave or took away his real name. Okay, because if there's any connection, right? Once he's disappeared into the South, into those plantations with all those slaves, and he's got a slave name, and nobody knows his original name. That's why they beat him. That's why it's pointless for him to assert his freedom. Because the more he says the name Solomon Northup, the more likely he is to just be killed. Okay? He has to keep that a secret. But in keeping it a secret, he makes it harder to be found. So, yes, that is absolutely the case. All right. So, we get to the whole issue with, Henry goes and he meets up with the Honorable John P. Waddill, a legal gentleman of distinction, a man of fine genius and most noble impulses. All right, so we've got him. Waddill is clearly of the same mind as the senator, right? This is something, you know, he in common with others of like elevated character looked upon the kidnapper with abhorrence, the title of his fellow parishioners and clients to the property which constituted a larger portion of their wealth. Not only depended upon the good faith in which slave sales were transacted, but he was a man in whose honorable heart emotions of indignation were aroused by such an instance of injustice. Okay? So in other words, if we can't guarantee this is all on the up and up, why do you think you have to register your car purchases? Right? Why do you have a title to your car? Because if you can't have an actual title to your car, how do you know it's your car? How are there any legal you know, recourses to the bank if they want to repossess your car or your house or anything else you own, right? That's why we have this idea about property and why the law is so incredibly important. Okay, so then we have this whole idea of providentially. Providentially goes to Adele right away. We see them. He points out that there's so many slaves in the bayou, right? And Waddell and Northup are sitting around one evening, and they're, you know, sharing some cigars or whatever, and talking about the state of politics, right? And you hear Mr. Waddell commenting about how in the 1850s we've got this fracturing of the political parties, which if you listen to the lecture, you kind of are getting familiar with. And they talk about that, and they start talking about, you know, people that are opposed to slavery. And Northup says, you know, you have seen one of those in these parts of the country, I presume. I mean, surely you have people that oppose slavery down here, right? Ha, ha, ha. How funny. How naive, Mr. Northup. Never but once, answered Waddell laughingly, we have one here in Marksville, an eccentric creature who preaches abolitionism as vehemently as any fanatic in the North. He is a generous, inoffensive man, but always maintaining the wrong side of an argument. It affords us a deal of amusement. He is an excellent mechanic and almost indispensable in this community. He is a carpenter. His name is Bass. Okay? So, another insight into why they indulge him. They need him. We have a real lack of industry in the South. Okay? FYI, that's going to matter when we get to the Civil War. They don't have a lot of skilled mechanics and engineers. So when they get one, they can be a little bit different. They can be drunk like Tibbetts. They can be an abolitionist like Bass. You make exceptions, right? Because you got to. All right. So then Waddell all of a sudden has the light bulb moment. He goes, wait a minute. And that's where the postscript matters. He that is writing for me is taking his life and putting his life at risk. And Waddell goes, ha, I think I might know who did the letter writing. Okay? Because what they're faced with is how do they figure out where Northup is. So now they go find Bass. Why the kind of playing games with Bass? What is the concern here? Y'all are killing me. Am I moving too fast? Is that what the issue is? Are y'all like, I don't remember. Yes, Bass doesn't know whether or not to trust him, and right, it's a delicate situation, right? Lots of need for discretion until finally they discover the truth, okay? And that's where the key is, okay? So that little piece of that, like I said, that divine, you know, inspiration that Waddell has of, oh my gosh, yeah, there's this Bass guy, right? I mean, think about how unlikely all of that is. So here's the thing. You've got the law as the hinge upon all of this stuff, the thing that holds slavery together and kind of keeps it grounded. And yet, look at how difficult it is to get the law to do the right thing, okay? It's incredibly difficult, incredibly challenging. All right, so then we see it was determined to commence legal proceedings to test the question of my right to freedom. Again, the law. They have to create a legal proceeding in order to prove his freedom. With Mr. Northup acting as my guardian, because obviously Platt cannot represent himself in the South. And then you have Edwin Epps, defendant. Sheriff... The process to be issued was in the nature of a writ leven, directed to the sheriff of the parish, commanding him to take me into custody and detain me until the decision of the court. So he was going to be held by the sheriff until the court decided what to do with him. Until one Sunday afternoon, what happens next? What happens after Bass has revealed his location and they've begun the court proceedings? They're getting ready to go get him. They've talked to the sheriff. Mm-hmm. Hey, we need to go over here and get this guy. But something comes down on Sunday. What was it?
Something happens, and they know people will start talking, and they'll go talk to X, and then they'll go to
Y. Yes. Specifically, what happens?
Bass, he was trying to leave the state, but then he told one of his friends, and the friends betrayed him, and so there was like rumors.
Yes. He basically, and he doesn't even tell his friend, about exactly why he's leaving the state. Just, I'm going to leave the state, right? Except they've had this newcomer come in. This guy clearly from up north, okay? So they're putting two and two together, all right? They don't know for sure, but rumor has it this guy from up north has come down. Rumor has it there's legal proceedings started about some slave. And now Bass is telling people, I'm going to leave the state. So now people are putting it together, okay? Again, it just, you know, it doesn't even matter, right? That's the thing. So it doesn't matter that it's just. It doesn't matter that the law is in place, that they're working through the system the right way. None of that matters to some of these people, okay? Because they weren't going to let a slave disappear like that. The value, the power of the white system, the hierarchy there, they weren't going to let that get challenged just for the law, just for some class. Really? Oh, my goodness, right? Okay, so we definitely see that they have to rush off to go, so they leave that night, right? So it's Monday morning when they get there. And so that's where you see them coming up to Epps' plantation. Why does Bass have to leave quickly? Crap, I'm going to run out of time. Okay. Why does Bass have to leave quickly?
Mm-hmm. He knows if he's around whenever Epps finds out that he might think and like put two and two together and then...
Well, I would bet it's more than just... But I think they know.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, he's a dead man. Yeah, he's a dead man walking. He's got to get out of there. How does the sheriff propose to prove who Platt is?
I asked him five questions.
Yes, they're going to ask him questions because, you know, just in case, again, look at the layers to this legal system, right? And yet, all it takes is some rumor mongering to thwart all of that. That's how, so as much as there's proof on Northup's part to prove who he is, the ability to hold him requires so little. And again, the injustice of it all, right? What is Epps' reaction when he finds out? Why does he blame the victim and threaten Bass and ride off the board? Why does he blame the victim? Of course, the whole like recognition seems pretty powerful. Let's see. Platt, do you know this gentleman? Right? He lives in New York. Did you ever live there? Yes, master, born and bred there. You was free then? Now you blah, blah, blah. Why did you not tell me when I bought you? It's your fault. Wasn't my responsibility to know. Gee, I don't know. Why do you think you wouldn't have told him? Master Epps, you did not take the trouble to ask me. Okay? Then he skips over that, right? Skips over the story being beaten. Seems there's been a letter written for you by somebody. Now, who is it? Okay? What if I wrote it? Again, shifting the blame anywhere else. Okay? He's upset about losing Platt. That swore that if he only had an hour's notice of his coming, he would have saved him the trouble of taking me back to New York, that he would have run into the swamp or some other place out of the way, and where all the sheriffs on earth couldn't have found me. So yeah, so much for justice and the law, right? All right, we see the mistress's concern. I'm going to kind of rush through this. Let's see. Presently, Mistress Epps made her appearance. She said many things to me and wondered why I had not told her. She expressed her regret, complimenting me by saying she'd rather lose any other servant on the plantation. Now there was no one left who could mend a chair or a piece of furniture. No one who was any of any use about the house. No one who could play for her on the violin. She was actually affected to tears. Poor thing. So, yes. Then you've got Patsy, right? Oh, Platts, you're going to be free. You've saved me a good many whippings, Platts. I'm glad you're going to be free, but oh, the Lord, what'll become of me? Okay? Epps goes off to Ford to confront him. And then we see there has to be a court hearing. So how does it turn out for Epps? Does he ever manage to prove anything? The law ends up being on Northrop's side. At this point, finally, the law is on his side. Finally, for the first time. And notice they take no time in leaving whatsoever. They leave extremely quickly. So that is, like I said, that's really the climax of the story, okay? Right there. That's where you get to the whole idea of what's happening. All right, so we ended up talking about this the whole class. Next class will come in, and you'll take the quiz on Northrop. We'll start the reform movements. I may push the deadline back a little bit. The gist of this is going to be it's kind of an independent learning assignment. I did kind of do a quick overview lecture on it, but I want you to go into a little more detail about it, and it's going to be worth 15 points, but you can work in groups on it. And in essence, it's that you will look up through reliable sources. Tertiary sources are fine, so Encyclopedia Britannica, textbooks, blah, blah, blah. Essential identifications and definitions, as well as primary characteristics and goals. I've also included links to primary sources and some secondary sources for you to start looking at. Please include a reference to those documents and sites that are listed in blue that are hyperlinked. Then evaluate how each one of these reform movements tried to solve issues of the early 19th century. Be sure to address the driving and secondary questions. So we'll, if you want to get a head start, you can. You can kind of get yourselves in a group of people. Try not to make it too many people, but I'm not going to really put limits on it. The big thing is you need to understand what these movements are. You need to reflect on these documents and how they're trying to kind of resolve this issue in the market economy, the sense of disconnect that's happening because of the expansion. Individualism's being challenged. Liberty's being challenged. Equality's being challenged, right? How do I find my place in an American society when you have these large economic and legal and political forces at play, right? So these people are trying to do this, and so they turn to these various reform movements in order to do that. And so I want you to kind of explore those. So I have kind of the brief overview lecture, but you can go in, and I want you to dig a little deeper onto it. I said I'll probably push the deadline back a little bit since we didn't get any start on it at all today, but you can go ahead and start on it on your own time. Regionalized lecture, be sure you're listening to that. I have a quiz scheduled for next Tuesday on that one. If you go to the About and pull up the Google Calendar, you can see what the deadlines are. Don't forget your annotated bibliographies coming up here pretty quick. Come on, catch up with me. Thank you. Stop it. Okay. So you can see, like I said, quiz is here. I said I'll push that reform movement back some. So, okay. This is where the regionalized lectures have to be done. Got it? All right, that's it. I got 1 minute. 1 whole minute. I talked about this the whole class. Yay. I'm sure the people listening on the video lecture or in the recording are going to be so thrilled at 90 minutes of Northrop.